Today we're in the Psalms, and we're going to be looking at Psalms 58 through 61. And so we better begin at verse 1 here in Psalm 58. I'll read the psalm to you, and we'll get into our study. Psalm 58, beginning at verse 1. David writes, "Do you indeed speak righteousness, you silent ones? Do you judge uprightly, you sons of men? No, in heart you work wickedness. You weigh out the violence of your hands in the earth. The wicked are estranged from the womb. They go astray as soon as they are born, speaking lies. Their poison is like the poison of a serpent. They are like the deaf cobra that stops its ears, which will not heed the voice of charmers, charming ever so skillfully. Break their teeth in their mouth, O God." I'm sorry. "Break out the fangs of the young lions, O Lord. Let them flow away as waters which run continually. When he bends his bow, let his arrows be as if cut in pieces. Let them be like a snail which melts away as it goes, like a stillborn child of a woman that may not see the sun. Before your pots can feel the burning thorns, he shall take them away as with a whirlwind, as in his living and burning wrath. The righteous shall rejoice when he sees the vengeance. He shall wash his feet in the blood of the wicked, so that men will say, 'Surely there is a reward for the righteous. Surely he is God who judges the earth.'" Another one of those sweet psalms of David. This is called an imprecatory psalm. We don't use the word imprecatory very often now, do we? When's the last time you used that? I mean, it's not a word that we use generally, but it's one of those psalms that is referred to as imprecatory because what he is doing is he's really calling a curse from God on evildoers, and that's what the word imprecatory means, to be calling down a curse from God or invoking evil. And what he is doing here is he's basically speaking concerning God's judgment, and in prophetic sense, he's speaking concerning the reality of that. God is going to judge the wicked, and he's going to reward the righteous, and that's what you see here in Psalm 58. Now, as we begin, I want you to notice in verses 1 and 2 how he begins this psalm by simply saying, "Do you indeed speak righteousness, you silent ones? Do you judge uprightly, you sons of men?" Then he answers that question in verse 2 by saying, "No. In heart you work wickedness, you weigh out the violence of your hands in the earth." So he's saying to the judges, and that's who he's speaking to, by the way, when he speaks of the judges, "Do you judge uprightly, sons of men?" It's another way of speaking to the rulers and the judges. And he's asking the question, "Do you judge righteously?" We need to remember that in Scripture, the Lord has made it very clear for us that judgment needs to be done in a righteous fashion. It needs to be fair and it needs to be right. And God intended people everywhere to have fair treatment whenever justice was needed. You can see that all through the Bible, but if you take notes, you can see that in the book of Deuteronomy and in chapter 16, verses 18 and 19. Listen to what Moses writes. "You shall appoint judges and officers in all your gates, which the Lord your God gives you, according to your tribes, and they shall judge the people with just judgment. You shall not pervert justice. You shall not show partiality, nor take a bribe, for a bribe blinds the eye of the wise and twists the words of the righteous." So God intended people to have fair treatment whenever justice was needed, and the standard was to be the Word of God. Inasmuch as the nation of Israel is what is referred to as a theocratic nation, meaning that God is the one who rules over that nation, it's a theocracy, in that Israel is a theocratic nation, their standard of justice was to be found in Scripture. In Deuteronomy, again, in chapter 17, in verses 18 through 20, we read, "It shall be when the king sits on the throne of his kingdom that he shall write for himself a copy of this law in a book from the one before the priests, the Levites. It shall be with him, he shall read it all the days of his life, that he may learn to fear the Lord his God and be careful to observe all the words of this law and these statutes, that his heart may not be lifted above his brethren, that he may not turn aside from the commandment to the right hand or the left, and that he may prolong his days in his kingdom, he and his children in the midst of Israel." The king was to know the word of God and rule righteously by the word of God. The justice system was to be meted out according to the standards of God, and therefore righteous judgment was what God intended for the nation. What we see here in this particular psalm is David confronting the unrighteous judges who have been judging wickedly. And I believe that God's standard of judgment still needs to be a righteous standard. Without going into a long harangue, which I'm easily bent on doing, when he asks the question, "Do you judge uprightly, you sons of men?" And then he answers it and says, "No, in heart you work wickedness. You weigh out the violence of your hands in the earth." He's simply saying, are you ruling properly? Are you using the right standards? Are you doing so in such a way that it brings justice to all? And then he answers that question by saying, no, you're not. You're not using the right standard. As a matter of fact, you are judging in an unrighteous fashion. We see that, of course, in our day all the time. And without going into a lot of incidents and all, I note that in our justice system today, we have some judges, many judges really, it appears at least many judges, who do not use proper standards when they mete out justice and make their decisions. We have what are called today justices who are really more intent on changing society through the rulings in the law. We can see that often. We see it all the time. If we watch the news or if we read the newspaper, I was thinking today about the federal ban on partial birth abortion. I was there for the signing of that bill, and immediately we have justices who overturned that and challenged that. We see that all the time. I was thinking of the state ban on same-sex marriage that was overturned in Massachusetts and other states. And the federal push towards an amendment banning same-sex marriage was initially defeated. We see that taking place often, even in our day. We see these things occurring. If you have the will of the people that states that we don't want to see these particular things being done, you can always get an activist judge who will overturn the will of the people and write into law those things that he desires. So is justice really, really being meted out today by righteous people? The answer, of course, is no. Were righteous people judging during the time of David's writing? And the answer he gives to us is no. He says in verse 2, in heart you work wickedness, you weigh out the violence of your hands in the earth. Because the judges are unrighteous, the nation is becoming perverted. And that's because they're not listening to the word of God, and therefore the judgment will be perverse. The Bible tells us in Proverbs 29, verse 2, when the righteous are in authority, the people rejoice, but when a wicked man rules, the people groan. I find it interesting to note that we have some who will say that they, on a personal level, are opposing abortion, but politically, they have to protect that. And I find that an interesting dichotomy. On the one hand, you say, I oppose this, but on the other hand, I will protect this. That doesn't make any sense to me. And yet we see people who don't allow their religious beliefs, or at least their apparent religious beliefs, actually in any way, shape, or form affect the way that they think and the things that they do. And so we're seeing that take place even right now. In verse 3, he continues and says, the wicked are estranged from the womb. They go astray as soon as they're born, speaking lies. Their poison is like the poison of a serpent. They're like deaf cobras, like the deaf cobra that stops its ear, which will not heed the voice of charmers, charming ever so skillfully. In other words, they are wicked from birth. They're selfish and they're deceptive, he's saying, from the beginning. They're like trained snakes who rebel against a handler. And the point he's making is that they're insensitive to God, they're insensitive to righteousness, and they indeed are insensitive to justice. And so he speaks here, and he says in verse 6, a very sweet thing, break their teeth in their mouth, O God. Break out the fangs of the young lions, O Lord. Let them flow away as waters which run continually. When he bends his bow, let his arrows be as if cut in pieces. Let them be like a snail which melts away as it goes, like a stillborn child of a woman that may not see the sun. Before your pots can feel the burning thorns, he shall take them away as with a whirlwind, as in his living and burning wrath. And so he prays that God will do six things. Notice these six things. First, he says, break their teeth in their mouth. When he says break their teeth in their mouth, he's saying render them incapable of doing harm. That's the point that he's making. You know, a lion with broken teeth isn't going to do as much harm as one that has a full set. The second thing he says is let them flow as water. In other words, may their courage dry up and may it evaporate. A third thing he says in verse 7 is, when he bends his bow, make his arrows really ineffective. Let his arrows be as if cut in pieces. Make his attacks ineffective. In verse 8, interesting, let them be like a snail which melts away as it goes. There was a type of snail, if you will. It was called a slime worm. that when it would be hit by the sun, and even to this day we see that take place with snails, when the sun hits them, evaporates them, and actually just dries them up. We know that. I mean, those of you who garden, you go out into your garden and you see these little snails, and they're trying to run away from you, but they're not moving very fast. And you go and you smash them up or do whatever it is that you do with them. I used to have a cocker spaniel that would eat them. Yeah, that's true. And my son David has a very weak stomach. And so I said, Dave, come on, I want to show you a trick that I taught Buster. And so little David came out and I said, watch this. And I picked up a snail and I threw it in the air, you know, and the dog would jump up and eat it because the dog was actually a French dog. You know, he liked to eat snails. But anyway, I throw it in, and oh, David would get so sick. There's really no reason in me telling you that other than I just thought about it. But they do. I mean, they evaporate. You know, when you take your snail pellets and you put them out there in the garden, that does not poison them. What it does is it paralyzes them. You know that. And as it paralyzes them, when the sun comes out, the sun evaporates them, and that's how they die. That's how the snails die, is you actually are paralyzing them, not necessarily poisoning them. And that's the point he's making. Let them just dry up. Continuing, he speaks in verse 8 again, like a stillborn child of a woman that may not see the sun. In other words, may their death be sudden. In verse 9, before your pots can feel the burning thorns, he shall take them away as with a whirlwind, as in his living and burning wrath. And finally, remove them before they, like a raging fire, can do their evil deeds. So six things he asked God to do here in order to deal with those who are evil. And his point is, Lord, render them ineffective and deal with them in your righteous judgment. In verse 10, the righteous shall rejoice when he sees the vengeance. He shall wash his feet in the blood of the wicked, so that men will say, surely there is a reward for the righteous. Surely he is God who judges the earth. This is a picture when he says, and I want you to see this, he shall wash his feet in the blood of the wicked. This is a metaphor declaring the joy the righteous will have when justice is served. It's a picture of joyful triumphing over an enemy. And he's saying the godly will share the joy of the Lord when God judges over his enemies. Proverbs 11 verse 10 says it this way, when it goes well with the righteous, the city rejoices. When the wicked perish, there is jubilation. And so the righteous shall rejoice when he sees the vengeance. When God does his work, those who have been praying for the Lord to move on their behalf rejoice when God brings his judgment and brings victory. And that is the joy that we have when we see God deliver us. Psalm 59. Deliver me from my enemies, O my God. Defend me from those who rise up against me. Deliver me from the workers of iniquity. Save me from bloodthirsty men. For look, they lie in wait for my life. The mighty gather against me. Not for my transgression, nor for my sin, O Lord. They run and prepare themselves through no fault of mine. Awake to help me, and behold. You therefore, O Lord, God of hosts, the God of Israel, awake to punish all the nations. Do not be merciful to any wicked transgressors. Selah. At evening they return, they growl like a dog and go all around the city. Indeed, they belch out with their mouths. Swords are in their lips, for they say, who hears? For you, O Lord, shall laugh at them. You shall have all the nations in derision, O you, his strength. I will wait for you, for God is my defense. My merciful God shall come to meet me. God shall let me see my desire on my enemies. Do not slay them, lest my people forget. Scatter them by your power and bring them down, O Lord, our shield, for the sin of their mouth and the words of their lips. Let them even be taken in their pride for the cursing and lying which they speak. Consume them in wrath. Consume them that they may not be. And let them know that God rules in Jacob to the ends of the earth, Selah. And at evening they return, they growl like a dog and go all around the city. They wander up and down for food and howl if they're not satisfied. But I will sing of your power. Yes, I will sing aloud of your mercy in the morning, for you have been my defense and refuge in the day of my trouble. To you, O my strength, I will sing praises, for God is my defense, the God of my mercy. And so Psalm 59 is another one of the psalms that is written under the conditions of David being a hunted man. And he's praying that God will deliver and defend him from his enemies who have risen in opposition against him. That's what he says in verse 1. And I want you to see this, 1 and 2, where he says, "Deliver me from my enemies, O my God. Defend me from those who rise up against me. Deliver me from the workers of iniquity. Save me from bloodthirsty men." And so he has men who are following after him, and he's a hunted man, and he begins now to pray that God will deliver him. Verse 3, he says, "For look, they lie in wait for my life. The mighty gather against me. Not for my transgression, nor for my sin, O Lord. They run and prepare themselves through no fault of mine. Awake to help me, and behold, you therefore, O Lord, God of hosts, the God of Israel, awake to punish all the nations. Do not be merciful to any wicked transgressors." Selah. These people hate me for no reason, is what he's saying. I haven't transgressed, and I haven't sinned against any of them. What is it that I can do? I haven't done anything to provoke them, and yet they're pursuing me without cause. They hate me without a reason. What is it that I can do? What should I do? Well, I asked you to deliver me, and I asked you to defend me. I asked you to take care of me, because I know that you will. I call upon you, he says in verse 5. I'm asking you to awaken and punish them, and don't be merciful to any wicked transgressors. Take care of me. I call upon you. You will deliver me. In Psalm 35:23, he said, "Stir up yourself, awake to my vindication, to my cause, my God and my Lord." Psalm 25:20 says, "Keep my soul, deliver me, let me not be ashamed, I put my trust in you." You have options. Anytime somebody is opposing you, you have options. Keep that in mind. You have an option to either defend yourself, and a lot of people will do that immediately, to defend yourself. And you'll say, "Well, who's going to defend me if I don't defend myself?" Well, you have options. You can defend yourself. Or you can say, "God, you defend me." You can try and deliver yourself. Or you can say, "God, will you deliver me?" You can fight your own battle and take your chances. Or you can cast your care on the Lord and say, "God, you are my defense. You are my refuge. You are my security. You are my protector. You know all the truth. You know the ins and the outs of all of this. You know that they're hunting me without cause. You know that they're laying traps for me, and I haven't done anything against them. I can't understand why they're so mad at me, and it bothers me and even hurts me to admit that this is true. But Lord, I can't do anything about it. If I begin to defend myself, then it's going to look as if I'm guilty. And no matter what I say, I'm still going to look like I'm in the wrong. So, Lord, I'm going to ask you to do something. I'm going to ask you to take care of me. You know that I'm innocent in all of this. You know I haven't done what they're saying that I have done. But, Lord, you're the one who's going to deliver me, and therefore I ask that you will. I'm asking you to keep me, to protect me, to deliver me, because, Lord, you know everything about me, and you know that I need your help. Notice how he describes this in verse 6 and 7. "At evening they return and growl like a dog and go all around the city. Indeed, they belch out with their mouth, swords are in their lips, for they say, who hears?" They're growling like a dog. They're terrorizing the city like a pack of wild dogs. Not only that, but they're mocking God as if God doesn't hear what is going on. They belch, notice verse 7, out with their mouth, swords are in their lips, and they say, "Who hears?" God doesn't hear is what they're saying. God doesn't see what is taking place. It's as if, well, God hasn't moved, so there must not be a God, or we must not be doing anything wrong. And so he's crying out that the Lord would note what they're doing. If you take notes, Psalm 94, verses 7 through 9 reads, "They say, the Lord does not see, nor does the God of Jacob understand. Understand, you senseless among the people, you fools. When will you be wise? He who planted the ear, shall he not hear? He who formed the eye, shall he not see?" You think the one who created you to have eyes and ears in the first place can't see and hear himself? You think that you can say things and all and get away with it as if he's not listening to you? Well, the point is if he created the ear and he created the eye, then he can hear and he can see. And for you to think that he's not listening is great foolishness. For you to think that you're getting away with something and that God hasn't taken notice is a very unwise thing to do. As a matter of fact, in verse 8, he continues and says, "You, O Lord, shall laugh at them. You shall have all the nations in derision. O you, his strength, I will wait for you. For God is my defense. My merciful God shall come to meet me. God shall let me see my desire on my enemies." Lord, you're going to have the last laugh. You're going to protect me, because you love me. I have come to understand something about you, God. You are merciful, and you will receive me to yourself. You will take care of me. The psalmist in Psalm 54:5 said, he will repay my enemies for their evil. I'm going to trust you to take care of me in every circumstance and every situation. Notice verse 11, do not slay them, lest my people forget. Scatter them by your power. Bring them down, O Lord, our shield, for the sin of their mouth and the words of their lips. Let them even be taken in their pride, and for the cursing and lying which they speak. Consume them in wrath. Consume them that they may not be. Let them know that God rules in Jacob to the ends of the earth. May the judgment be gradual, not immediate. And may it be so severe that people will know that you are busy judging them. May it be so severe and so slow that people will have time to realize that something from you is taking place, something called judgment. I'm not asking you to kill them immediately. I'm simply saying bring them down. I'm saying deal with them and bring glory to yourself. Verse 14, and at evening they return. They growl like a dog and go all around the city. They wander up and down for food and howl if they're not satisfied. They're like angry dogs that never get enough, and they begin to growl at you. Years ago, when we moved into our home, the area that we live in, there were coyotes. And my son David was a lot younger then, and he would sleep with a baseball bat, and he would open his window just a little bit so the air would come in, but he would sleep with a little baseball bat. So finally one day I asked him, I said, son, may I ask you why you have a baseball bat? And he says, in case a coyote comes in my room. I said, is he going to get on his hind legs and use his little paws to slide the window open after he removes the screen? Is that how come you have this little club there? And he says, well, Dad, you never know. I said, fine. So he just sleep with his little baseball bat next to him. It's one of these little souvenir bats you get from a dog. I mean, like it would really hurt. But I didn't tell him anything. I said, okay, fine, son. Sleep with that club. Well, I didn't think that he'd ever encounter a coyote or anything like that. Well, one day, he had a little cat, and the cat has died a long time ago now, but he had a cat, a little calico, and we wouldn't let her outside. She had become a house cat because of the coyotes and all. And one day, we left the front door open, and Callie, our calico cat, had gotten outside. Now, that cat was very special to David, and so he immediately noticed that the door is open and the cat is gone. And so what he did is he rushed out to the front yard, and there she was kind of sniffing around in the very front, and he picks her up. And she was one of these cats that would just kind of go limp whenever you picked her up. He'd pick her up, and she'd just go limp in the arms, and he brought her in, and you could see him bringing in this cat. She's just kind of laying like that. She's bad cat, that kind of thing. And he brought her in, and he's scolding her, and he puts her down, and he says, you shouldn't go outside. You're not supposed to go outside, and he closes the door and locks it, right? And so I said, son, could you throw the trash? And he says, all right. He goes out the back. And all of a sudden, he comes running in the house. And what had happened is there was a coyote in the backyard next to the trash. And David had opened the door up, and there's a coyote standing next to the trash just looking at him. And my son, he freaked out. And he came running into the house, and he's all screaming like a girl and all. And, and the dog took off. And so, those coyotes, I get two illustrations from this. One is you can hear them at night as they're howling and they're going after animals. And sometimes in the neighborhood, I've heard when dogs have been eaten by them. Because you'll hear the dog starting to bark and then you hear the blood-curdling sound and you know a coyote has gotten hold of one of the dogs. And so David had justifiable concern for Kelly. That's why he brought her in, because the dogs will go out, they prowl, they're vicious, and they do destroy. But secondly, something the Lord really taught me through that was this. It was the love that David had for that little cat that drove him to search her out when she was in danger. And even though that cat didn't realize that she was in danger, David, like a little shepherd, knew that he needed to protect her even when she was unaware of it. And what I think had happened is a coyote had smelled the cat. And the coyote had come over one of the fences, gone down the side of my house, and was actually standing next to the next fence that it would have jumped over to get to the front of the house to get to the cat. And had David not gone out when he did, then Kelly would have been that coyote's dinner. And the Lord spoke to my heart and pointed out that that's how a shepherd ought to be, aware at all times of, to the best of their ability, that there's danger for the one that he cares for, and that the enemy is always seeking that he might devour. And so the shepherd has the responsibility of calling out a warning and protecting that little sheep. David is crying out here saying that evil is in the city. And he's saying, Lord, I am asking you to deal with it justly, because they're like wild dogs that are howling because they haven't eaten enough. Evil, they haven't had enough evil, and they want even more. They haven't destroyed enough, and they want to destroy more. And so he's saying, Lord, I'm asking you to deal with them. Verse 13, consume them in wrath. Consume them that they may not be. Now, in verse 16, but he says, I will sing of your power. I will sing aloud of your mercy in the morning, for you have been my defense and refuge in the day of my trouble. To you, O my strength, I will sing praises, for God is my defense, the God of my mercy. And so, Lord, I'm going to just bless you and praise you forever, because you have been merciful towards me, and your mercy has caused me to sing to you. You have been my fortress. You have been my deliverer. You have been my protector, and Lord, I want you to know how much I love you. In Psalm 116, verse 1, the psalmist said, I love the Lord because he heard my voice and my supplications. Lord, I just want you to know that I love you with all of my heart. And when I sing, I'm not singing to man. When I sing, I'm not singing to the person next to me, behind me, in front of me. I'm singing to you, and I praise you because you have delivered me. And I want you to know, because you have been my defense, you have been my refuge, you have been my strength. Because this is true, then Lord, because of your mercy and you have loved me, I love you, and I will sing praises to you. And verse 17, when he calls the Lord his strength, that is something that we need to underline in our own hearts. What is your strength, and where does your strength come from? David said, my strength comes from you. You are the one who is with me. You are the one who strengthens me, and I bless you in song. Psalm 60. Oh God, you have cast us off. You have broken us down. You've been displeased. Oh, restore us again. You have made the earth tremble. You've broken it. Heal its breaches, for it is shaking. You've shown your people hard things. You've made us drink the wine of confusion. You have given a banner to those who fear you, that it may be displayed because of the truth, Selah, that your beloved may be delivered. Save with your right hand and hear me. God has spoken in his holiness. I will rejoice. I will divide Shechem and measure out the valley of Succoth. Gilead is mine and Manasseh is mine. Ephraim also is the helmet for my head. Judah is my lawgiver. Moab is my wash pot. Over Edom, I will cast my shoe. Philistia, shout in triumph because of me. Who will bring me into the strong city? Who will lead me to Edom? Is it not you, O God, who cast us off? And you, O God, who did not go out with our armies? Give us help from trouble, for vain is the help of man. Through God we will do valiantly, for it is he who shall tread down our enemies. So he's saying in verses 1 and 2, basically, God, I have feeling I am distant from you. It feels like I'm on the other side of the world. You have cast us off. You have broken us down. You have been displeased. Restore us again. You've made the earth tremble. You've broken it. Heal its breaches, for it is shaking. You have shown your people hard things. You have made us drink the wine of confusion. You've been angry, and I'm crying out for you to deliver us and save us. Notice verses 4 and 5, he says, you have given a banner to those who fear you, that it may be displayed because of the truth. You've given us a banner to identify with, is the point he's making. You've given to us like a place of security. That banner is like we see it and we rush to it in order that you might protect us. We have run to you so that you might protect us, and Lord, you will do that because you are powerful. Now, I want you to notice something when he says in verses 2 and 3 when he says, you have made the earth tremble, you have broken it, heal its breaches, it's shaking, you've shown your people hard things, you've made us drink the wine of confusion. At the moment, Lord, we're staggering and we're not sure what's going on, but you've given to us in the midst of all of this a place that we can run to. And I'm asking you to protect and keep me. Notice verse 5, that your beloved may be delivered, save with your right hand, and hear me. In the Bible, very often the right hand is a place of power and protection. It's a place of authority. And you'll see this often as we go through the Psalms. It speaks of a place of authority. That's why the Bible speaks to us concerning Jesus Christ, who is now at the right hand of the Father. When he says he's at the right hand of the Father, it's another way of saying he's at a place of power and authority, and that's where Jesus Christ is seated. And so when he speaks concerning the right hand, it's a picture of God's authority and power and ability to deliver. And that's why he says, save with your right hand and hear me. In verse 6, he says, God has spoken in his holiness, and I will rejoice. I will divide Shechem, measure the valley of Succoth. Gilead is mine, Manasseh is mine, Ephraim is mine. Ephraim is the helmet of my head. Judah is my lawgiver. And he begins to speak concerning this. And basically all that is he's saying, I've made promises. And I know that I will keep those promises as I have given them out. And my promise has been to be with these nations, or these peoples. See, Shechem, Succoth, Gilead, Manasseh, Ephraim, and Judah are all portions that make up the nation of Israel. Notice he speaks of Moab. And he speaks of Moab, which is interesting. Moab is my wash pot, and over Edom I've cast my shoe, and Philistia shout in triumph because of me. Not only do I have sovereignty over the portions of Israel that belong to me, but I also have sovereignty over the whole world. You see, sometimes people think that the faith that we have inherited from the nation of Israel, the Christian faith that we have, sometimes people think that faith is a faith of a Middle Eastern people that should have remained there. And now what is happening is they're saying, well, it's actually a Western faith. In reality, it's a faith that God has given to us that is supposed to affect the whole world. God has called, in other words, Christians to take the Christian faith out of Israel and into the whole world, because God is sovereign over the whole world. In the Old Testament, you will notice that often when the nation of Israel would go to war, that they would go to war against nations that actually believed that their gods were at battle with the nation of Israel's God. And what it would be really likened to is the battle of the gods. The armies of Israel would march against the armies of the nation they were fighting against. And the nation they were fighting against very often would think that their God was going to have the superiority over the nation of Israel's God. But during the time of the writing of the Old Testament, the nations would have their localized deities, and so they would believe in a certain god for that area. The nation of Israel had a god who was not a localized deity. It's the god of the whole earth, and that makes them unique and different. So when the nation of Israel would go to war against another nation, their god would give them the victory. And the people who were being defeated would recognize that it wasn't just the people of Israel defeating them, but they would have heard of the God that the nation of Israel worships and would recognize the superiority of the God of the nation of Israel over them. So when the psalmist is here speaking of these different geographic locations like Shechem and the valley of Succoth and Gilead and Ephraim and Manasseh and Judah, he's basically simply saying, you are the God over all of these areas that belong to the nation that you have drawn out of the world and made your own. But not only does Israel belong to you, but also Moab and Edom and even the place of the Philistines. Every one of them need to recognize that you are the God over the whole earth. In Deuteronomy 10:14, the Bible says, indeed, heaven and the highest heavens belong to the Lord your God, also the earth with all that is in it. So God controls and owns everything. In verse 9, who will bring me into the strong city? Who will lead me to Edom? Is it not you, O God, who cast us off? And you, O God, who did not go out with our armies? Now verse 11 is powerful. I mark this for myself to remember. Give us help from trouble, for vain is the help of man. Through God we will do valiantly, for it is he who shall tread down our enemies. We can begin a battle, but we soon discover that in that battle, God is not fighting for us. And that's what he's saying when he says in verse 9, who will bring me into the strong city? Who will lead me to Edom? Is it not you, O God, who cast us off? We have entered into battle, but we've discovered your presence is not with us. In discovering that, we now are asking you to come back to us, to our side. And I want you to see this. In verse 11, when he says, give us help from trouble, for vain is the help of man. One of the things that we need to, as believers, come to really understand that our help comes from the Lord. That's the one thing that you really, if I can leave something with you tonight that matters. All of this, of course, matters, but this is really an important thing for all of us to know. If you want to have victory, you need to understand that your victory doesn't come from people. It doesn't come because of people. The victory comes because the Lord is on your side. In your life, you need to understand that. You can't go around dividing life into the sacred and the secular. My job is secular, but when I serve the Lord, it's sacred. Everything you do is a holy offering to God. Everything. And whatever you do should be done as unto Him for His glory and for His sake. So that means that even when I'm driving home tonight, that should be a service as unto the Lord. Now, how can that be? Well, one, Lord, you know, sometimes I get cut off. Sometimes people run through red lights. Sometimes they roll through stop signs. I mean, there's a lot of things on the way home that can be dangerous and provoking. So, Lord, help me to keep my temper. Help me to not get all fleshed out. I have to tell you, one of my minor trials that actually gets me bugged is lousy drivers. That's the truth. I mean, I was driving up, you know, I was just trying, oh, might as well tell you. I was driving the other day. It's been a while now, but I was driving up a hill. And I saw a driver proceeding towards me, and they were coming down the hill, and I'm going up the hill, and there's a street that you can turn right into, and this driver is coming down the street, and he all of a sudden gets all the way to the right so that his car is like he's going to park. Then he turns and points his whole car, you know, towards the direction he wants to go. And I'm thinking, oh my, and I drove by just staring at him, thinking, what are you doing? You're crazy. I mean, there was this car, here's another one, Marie's on the freeway, and there's a car, the second from the right, and that car on the freeway stops. They stopped on the freeway because they were missing their off-ramp. And so all the cars are blowing past them so that they can turn and get off on their off-ramp. Unbelievable. I was driving on the 57 freeway, going to Anaheim. And I'm in the fast lane, the diamond lane is right next to me on my left, and a car comes towards me on the diamond lane, in the diamond lane. And the lady had her hands at 10 o'clock, 2 o'clock, and her face was as white as a ghost as she was proceeding towards traffic in the diamond lane at 60 miles, 65 miles an hour. And we called the police and said, you know, yeah, we've already heard several reports of that. I mean, these things freak me out. They really do. And I could name a whole lot of other things. I won't bother you with them. But, you know, even going home, you're in a spiritual time. It really is. You can take that time and say, Lord, just give me strength and all of that. Or you can get fleshed out just, you know, the minute you walk out. You could get fleshed out in the parking lot. You can be fleshed the minute you get in the house. You know, sometimes the enemy may not be necessarily running around in here. He's just waiting outside the door when you leave. And that's how it works. And so we need to know that, listen, vain is the help of man. Man can't help me in the spirit. I need God. I need God to give me victory. And I've had to learn, and I'm learning to cast all my cares on Him. And when I have needs, to ask Him for help. Because I could go and ask a lot of people for help, but my help comes from the Lord. And I need to understand that. And it's a very important principle that we need to learn. When he says, give us help from trouble, vain is the help of man. Through God we will do valiantly, for it is he who shall tread down our enemies. We need to cast our cares on him. And then finally, Psalm 61. Hear my cry, O God, attend to my prayer. From the end of the earth I will cry to you. When my heart is overwhelmed, lead me to the rock that is higher than I. For you have been a shelter for me and a strong tower from the enemy. I will abide in your tabernacle forever. I will trust in the shelter of your wings, Selah. For you, O God, have heard my vows. You have given me the heritage of those who fear your name. You will prolong the king's life, his years as many generations. He shall abide before God forever. Oh, prepare mercy and truth which may preserve him. So I will sing praise to your name forever, that I may daily perform my vows. So finally here in Psalm 61, I want you to notice something, and I want you to see if you can identify with any of this. I can. When he says in verses 1 and 2, hear my cry, O God, attend to my prayer. From the end of the earth I'll cry to you when my heart is overwhelmed. Lead me to the rock that is higher than I. And again, there are times when you can feel that you're on one side of the earth and God is on the other side. There are times, and that's basically what the psalmist is saying when he says, from the end of the earth I cry to you. There are times in my prayer life when I have felt that God is distant from me. I don't sense his presence as I once did. There are times when I've cried out to the Lord for help, and it feels like my prayer and the words are only going as far as my voice will carry, and then they fall like lead to the ground. There have been times when I've said, God, I need your help. Lord, I feel distant from you, and I'm asking you, will you attend to my need? Will you hear my cry? And that's what David is saying. Attend to my prayer. Hear me. Hear me as I cry out. From the end of the earth, I cry to you. When my heart is overwhelmed, lead me to the rock that is higher than I. Lord, it's like I'm in a valley and a flash flood has come, and I'm about to be overwhelmed and drowned and destroyed. And God, I am asking you to give me security. I'm asking you to lead me to the rock that is higher than I. So when it comes, the onslaught of the wave comes in and crashes through, I'll be above it as it goes below me. And I'm asking you to hear me because I feel overwhelmed and I'm crying out with need. And I know that no man can be a help to me. And therefore, I cry out to you in my time of distress. I've done that as a father. I've done that as a husband who was not doing well as a husband. And when I first got married to Marie, let's face it, it's like two rivers coming down from this hill and crashing together where they become the one. We have two different ways of thinking about so many different things, and then we become one, and where those two rivers meet, there's a crashing that does take place. And I've cried out, and I've said, Lord, you need to make me a more understanding husband, a more loving man. You need to help me to understand, you know, that I'm not always right, just most of the time, and you've got to help me to have humility. When you have your children, as a parent, and you're praying and saying, God, help me to be a godly individual. Help me to be a good person. When you feel like you're failing and things aren't going the way that they ought to, and you're being overwhelmed by circumstances and situations that are beyond your control, I need to be led to a rock that's higher than I am. Lord, I need to be placed in a position of protection and security. I need to be able to see the reality of the fact that though there are things that are going on, you can lift me above those things. And God, in you can provide for me a place of refuge and strength. You'll give me a vantage point so that I could see above, down, into, and realize that these things pass by, but I can remain untouched by them as long as you've got me in a place of security. And so, God, when my heart is overwhelmed, lead me to a rock that is higher than I. Lord, give me strength. Now, who is the rock that we run to? Jesus Christ is the rock. So, Lord, place me in him and shelter me so that when things that do overwhelm and could cause me great grief, when they do hammer me the way that they do, then, Lord, I'm just asking that you will strengthen me. So when my daughter, Corinne, approaches me and says to me, Papa, Daddy, I'm pregnant, and I'm sitting in my front room, and I look at her. This is my angel. This is my firstborn. This is my precious, whom I love with all of my heart. And she says, Daddy, I'm pregnant, and she's crying. And I look at her, and my first response was, I think I'm going to vomit. Seriously. Anybody understand what I just said? My stomach felt like it just hit the floor, and I literally felt sick to my stomach. I literally felt sick to my stomach, and I said, I think I'm going to vomit. I felt like somebody had hit me in the stomach and taken all of my strength from me. in just 1 second. Anybody know what I'm talking about? Does anybody know what I'm trying to say? Some of you do. I know you do. Some of you do. Lead me to the rock that is higher than I when I'm overwhelmed. So I come to the pulpit, and I'm doing a series in Ephesians, and I'm guarding my daughter, and I'm waiting for the right time to announce to my fellowship, who I love and I know love me, and there's no judgment I'm concerned with from you towards me. I know that. But I'm teaching on subjects like marriage and the family, and I give the message, and I go into the back, and I say, God, am I a hypocrite? Am I teaching something beyond my ability to do myself? Am I a hypocrite? And I cry out. And Marie cries out. Now, my baby girl said, Daddy, forgive me. And she spoke to my staff and said, I have sinned against God. I have sinned against my father. I have sinned against you. Will you forgive me? And my staff all embraced and wept with her. And we all, of course, said, you know, we're in this together, which we have been. We're in this together. We're family. We don't abandon those that belong to us. We're not out there in the world just saying, you're not perfect, you don't belong. No, we're all a band of sinners that have been saved by the grace of God. Not a single one of us is that good. And if we think we are, all we need to do is spend time with Jesus, and we realize we're really not that good. See, those who don't think they're that bad don't know the Lord. When you get close to Jesus Christ, you will say, oh, wicked person that I am. You'll be like the Apostle Peter when the Lord Jesus Christ said to him, cast the boat out and drop your net so you can catch some fish. And you know the story. And the Apostle Peter says, well, we've been fishing all night. We caught nothing. Yet at your command, I'll let down the nets. What was he saying? Well, he's saying, I'm a master fisherman and you're an itinerant rabbi. You're simply a carpenter who's now turned preacher. And you think you know something about fishing. Well, just because I want to humor you, I being the master fisherman and you being the itinerant rabbi carpenter and all of that. All right, you said so. And then what happens? You know the story. He drops down the net and the nets begin to break. And he gets so excited as he's pulling in all of these fish that it hits him finally. Wait a minute, this is not supposed to be happening. And he turns and he looks at Jesus. And what is it that he says to him? Depart from me, Lord, for I am a wicked man. The minute you come into contact with who he really is, that's the first response that you're going to make. Lord, I'm not good enough to be in your company. You see, it's the people who aren't spending time with the Lord who think they're better than the other people around them. When you start spending time with Jesus, I promise you, you spend time with the Lord and he's like a mirror. You look at yourself and see your imperfections and you see his glory, you get what is called humility. And so I never had a real problem with telling you. I knew that my church is a loving and caring and forgiving church. That's why I could bring my Josiah out last week on his first birthday and sing with you for my little boy. Because I know you love him, and not a single one of you ever made a judgmental statement to me about my daughter and about my Josiah. But you want to know something? I know what he's saying when he says, lead me to the rock that is higher than I. I know what he's saying when he says that. When I am being overwhelmed, when things are just rushing around me and I'm going to be drowned in them, Lord, I know in you I can have victory. I know in you I can have strength. I know in you I can overcome. So place me in the hand of Jesus Christ. Put me into the rock, Lord, that nothing can in any way, shape, or form get through. Just surround me because I need you. And that's what David is crying out here. Lead me to the rock that is higher than I. Why? Well, you have been a shelter for me, a strong tower from the enemy. I will abide in your tabernacle forever. I will trust in the shelter of your wings. The storms are threatening to drown me, but you're my shelter from the storm. And I will secure myself in the protection of your embrace. When I was a little boy, my mom got very ill. My mom has had a series of illnesses from the time I was 4 years old. And there were seasons in my mom's life when she had to be hospitalized. And I would come home from school and I'd be 6 years old and my mom wouldn't be there because mom had to be taken in to the hospital. And I can remember the insecurities of a little fella. I mean, my mom had an epileptic seizure when I was 4 years old. I had never seen anything like that at all. I was very sheltered and very much the son of my mother's heart. I was her favorite, if you will. I was the little vanilla baby that my mom would carry around that people used to think she was babysitting. Because I had red hair and I have green eyes and light skin. And my dad was dark-complected. My mama has black hair, brown eyes. And so they would look at my brother, who's a little chocolate guy. And they would look at my brother, and they'd look at me, and they'd ask my mom, who's the little boy you're babysitting? And it would insult me because I'm her son, you know. But I didn't look like one of the others and all of that. And so when my mom, you know, I was very attached to her. My mom says that I wouldn't go to anybody else, only her and some very special people. And that was about it as a child. And so as I grew older, I was very attached to her. And then one day I hear a sound of something hitting against the door, and I slide the door open, and my mother's body falls into the front room and falls at my feet. My mom's having an epileptic seizure, and I'm 4 years old, and my brother Frankie's 5.5 years old, 6 years old. And we haven't got a clue what's taking place. All I know is he says, you watch her, and I'm going to run out and get some help. And he runs across the street, and I'm standing there watching my mom having a seizure, and my sister Madeline, who's a year old, is sitting precariously on the edge of the sink there, because my mom had placed her on top of the right there by the water and all. And I'm watching my sister, but I can't get to her because my mom's body is between me and her. And I'm afraid, and I remember pressing my back against the wall with my mom's head at my feet. And I was 4 years old, and I remember saying, God, don't let my mother die. That's my earliest prayer that I remember. That was my prayer. God, don't let my mother die. And my brother comes home with a neighbor, and my mom is diagnosed with epilepsy. And so she's hospitalized. And I start being afraid my mom's going to die. Every time I get a phone call at school, your mom is not well. And it starts to work in you. So my mom, I would ask my mom to take me to church. And in church, my mom would sit in the pew. And as a little boy, 4, 5, 6 years old, I would cuddle next to my mom. I can still remember that. I would put my head underneath her, and my mom would place her arm around me, and I would rest on my mother. And I know what David is talking about here. I know what he's speaking about. You have been a shelter for me. I know what that feels like. You have been a tower for me. You've protected me, a tabernacle. And I will trust in the shelter of your wings. What is he saying? He's saying, you have put your arm around me, and you've embraced me, and you have held me. How many of you have a relationship with the Lord like that? Like that, where the Lord, well, you know, he embraces me. You see, that's a relationship. David didn't have a religion. David had a fellowship. That's what God wants us to have. He wants you and me to know that we can rest in the shadow of the Almighty. He wants us to know that you can actually say, place your arm around me, embrace me, and protect me, because the world that I live in is doing what it can to destroy me. And I can be overwhelmed by so much. So I need to be lifted above those things so that when they go past me, I sense a shelter and a protection and a refuge. So that in the midst of all of the struggle and all of the pain and all of the things that are working against me that will attempt to destroy my life, I know beyond a shadow of a doubt that my God is protecting me. And that's what he's saying here, and that is something that we would rejoice in together. For you, he says in verse 5, for you, O God, have heard my vows. You have given me the heritage of those who fear your name. You will prolong the king's life, his years as many generations. He shall abide before God forever. Prepare mercy and truth which may preserve him. So I will sing praise to your name forever, that I may daily perform my vows. I have made promises to you, and I will keep those promises. You have given me the heritage of those who fear your name. As your child and as one under your covenant promises, you have been true to your word. You have blessed me in so many ways. And because you have blessed me, verse 8, I will sing praise to your name forever. I will daily perform my vows. You have blessed me, and I will bless you. You bless me every day, and I praise you every day. You work in my life every day, and I thank you every day. The psalmist in Psalm 146:2 says, while I live, I will praise the Lord. I will sing praises to my God while I have my being. I will praise you every day. You see, we believers have something that the world doesn't have. We have joy. We have the ability to, on a daily basis, because the mercies of the Lord are renewed every morning, we have on a daily basis the ability to be thankful and to praise God every day for the good things that he has done for us. I was talking to a young person recently who was having some problems, and in essence, I said to them, well, that's life. Life has problems. Your problem is really going to be solved, though, when you get right with your God. Because if you're right with your God, everything else fits. With God, you can overcome. With God, you can have joy. With God, you can have peace. With God, you have forgiveness. But if you try to have those things without him, you're lost, you're doomed, you're helpless, and you're by yourself. So for me, I made my peace with the Lord when I was 20 years old, and I've been living in peace with him ever since. And I've been asking for his peace on a daily basis. Because I can have peace with God, but I also need the peace of God. I have peace with God because the war is over. God won. Jesus is the victor. I surrender. He's my Lord. He's my Savior. He's my master. I'm his servant. He's my captain. I follow him. So I have that peace. The war is over. But you know what I ask for on a daily basis? And I've said this to the Lord many times. Lord, I have peace with you. Now I need the peace from you. I need the peace that comes from you, that passes all understanding. So David is saying that. He's saying, I will sing praise to you and I will glorify you because you have led me to a rock that is higher than I, because you are a strong tower for me. And I'm not going to be afraid because I can be snuggling under the shelter of your wing. You embrace me, you protect me, and I love you for that. And I love you, Lord. And so when we sing to God, I love you, Lord, that's not just words to a song. That's a declaration of fact. I love you, Lord. I love you because you've been good to me. I love you because you'll be good to me tomorrow. And I love you because you will be good to me for eternity. And I will sing praises to you because you are good.